IVM. Hi, I'm Utsav, a behavior researcher by training and a slow traveler by passion. Postcards from Nowhere is a travel podcast where I condense a decade of travel experiences and explore not just the where, but also the why and how to travel. My stories emerged from slow traveling the less explored parts of the world: Bosnia and Herzegovina, Armenia, Uzbekistan, and even China. At the end of each story, I give practical tips and new ideas about how to travel better. This week, I take you to North Sikkim, when I made an attempt to see the famed Guru Dongmar Lake. But did I make it? We turned the taps. Not a drop flowed out. 6:50 a.m. Lachen Village, North Sikkim. I went down to the reception and asked the manager of our hotel. Apologetically, he said, "Sir, the pipes must have frozen. I will get the plumber to cut them open, unfreeze them, and then reseal them so that you can have water again." 9,000 feet above sea level at -1 degree. It was the end of February and we were 4 hours away from Guru Dongmar Lake, a place which lies high up in the northern reaches of Sikkim. At 17,000 feet, the average temperature is -10 degrees, with oxygen levels so low that no one can live there permanently. And yet, it remains the most coveted place to visit in all of Sikkim, because Guru Dongmar is rather unique. In a state where Buddhism dominates, the lake became famous thanks to Guru Nanak Dev, the Sikh Guru. Legend has it that on his visit to Tibet and China, the Guru passed by the lake. The shepherds of the region gathered before the Guru and pleaded before him about the problems of lack of drinking water in the region. Due to the extreme climate, the water of the lake would freeze and the shepherds had to melt it again and again. On hearing their plight, Guru Sahib took his walking stick, called dung in Punjabi, and he touched the lake with it. The area melted into water and since then has not frozen even when the temperatures have plunged to -30 degrees. It thus got the name Guru Dongmar and continues to be called so to this day. It thus got the name Guru Dongmar and continues to be called so to this day. The water of the lake is considered to be Amrit. We were still 4 hours away from Guru Dongmar Lake. This was attempt number 2. For the first one I made 5 years ago, never took off. I was traveling in the month of August and a landslide caused all roads to close. I never even left Gangtok, the capital of Sikkim. 5 years later, having made it halfway through as far as Lachen, things were not looking great. We had been told by our driver that the chances of going to the lake looked slim. With 2 days of bright sunshine, the snow had begun melting, causing the mud roads to turn slushy, thereby making it difficult even for 4x4 vehicles to navigate. Nevertheless, we left, and the landscape soon began to turn white. Entire tracts of mountains were covered by sheets of snow, with the pristine white snow glowing in the sunshine. We ascended to 13,000 feet and reached our last checkpoint, the army camp where our permits would be checked, or rather, the point where I would know if my wait of the last 5 years would end. Our guide Ashok came back and said, "The road to Guru Dongmar is closed. We can go up till Chopta Valley, but that's about it." Attempt 2 had failed too. Chopta Valley was gorgeous though. The entire valley was bathed in snow, and the only sound one heard was that of the winds as they caressed the mountains. Pine trees swayed and the sun shone brightly, giving us the much needed warmth in the biting cold. It was a perfect day in the mountains. But still, it wasn't Guru Dongmar, a dream which remained unfulfilled 5 years later. I dried my feet and got into the car. On the way back, just as we were nearing Chungthang, my eyes chanced upon a golden dome in the distance. A dome which was synonymous with only one thing, a Gurudwara. And my partner made sure we stopped. The Gurudwara was visited by Guru Nanak Dev on his journey to Tibet and China. And he named it Changi Than, or a beautiful place, which today is called Chungthang. When the Guru Sahib reached here, a demon stopped him and out of jealousy threw a large rock at him. But with a wave of his walking stick, the Guru stopped the rock. He then climbed on top of the rock and started singing the Gurbani. The demon fell under the spell of the melodious Gurbani and, ashamed of his deeds, asked the Guru for forgiveness. The marks of the Guru's feet and where he sat upon the rock can be seen to this day. But what's stranger is that the rock has a water fountain whose source remains unknown. The water is considered as Amrit. We looked around the entire Gurdwara complex but could not spot that stone. We asked the caretaker about it. He smiled and led us to a monastery adjacent to the Gurdwara. The famed rock, complete with footprints of the Guru, sat proudly in the middle of a Buddhist monastery. And what I did not tell you, that the Gurdwara is now known as Lama Sahib, respecting the Buddhist traditions of the region. It was heartwarming to see two places of worship sitting side by side, not only peacefully coexisting, but rather respectfully acknowledging each other. As we entered and prayed, my eyes spotted a steel water container. It was marked Guru Dongmar Jal, or water from the Guru Dongmar Lake. It felt surreal. All these years I was chasing a dream of going to the lake. And here, in the humble Gurdwara, I not only found the origin story, but also drank the water from that very lake, something even those who visit the lake cannot do. Attempt number 3, successful. On our travels, we sometimes become obsessed with places we want to go to. We make bucket lists, draw detailed itineraries, and plan it down to the T. However, it is important to sometimes just accept whatever comes our way. If you like this podcast, don't forget to check out other interesting podcasts on the IVM network. You can listen to us on the IVM Podcast app or ivmpodcast.com. You can also follow us on our social media. We are at IVM Podcasts on Twitter and Instagram. If you want to reach out to me, I am Utsav Memory on Twitter and YVTravel42 on Instagram.
I hope you enjoyed that show. I'd like to thank our sponsors this week, Intel, for supporting us. Great, great, great week on the network. If you haven't been listening, why haven't you been listening? You should be listening. Rohan Joshi was on Uncle Please Sit, discussed the toxicity of the Indian pop culture. Really, really fun conversation to listen to. Rajiv Saman, the founder of Sula Wines, was on Cyrus Says. Again, I think that was a fun conversation. Also want to call out the season finale of Yuddha. Yuddha is our military history podcast. Definitely do check that out. It's a really, really great listen. And finally, I want to just remind you all that, you know, it's a dark time, but if you need a smile, go check out the Smile India podcast by Shifa Mathra. It's in both English and Hindi, and I think that you will really, really enjoy the kinds of things that she's talking about there. And with that, I hope to see you again next week.
Advertising is dead. Yep, you heard me right. Advertising is dead. We're all in the content business now. Let's not call it news, TV, radio, etc., etc. It's all content, and we're in the middle of this weirdly exciting phase where all the borders and lines that have been drawn over decades has been swept away by this lovely thing called the internet. We're a show where we don't dwell on just the stuff that is now, but rather the wider stuff about advertising, media, content, and the whole goddamn circus surrounding it. Tune in every Tuesday for our weekly unboxing of the mystery box we used to call advertising. I'm Varun Dugirala, co-founder and content chief at The Glitch, and this is my new podcast, Advertising is Dead.